So I'm going to briefly note the rationale for international financial regulation, in particular the relation between harmonized capital requirements of Basel and the global financial crisis. So let me just briefly take a take on global regulation, which is related to what Andrew just talked about, the core rationale being to reduce systemic risk. And let me just note sort of the sort of standard economic market failure, as opposed to pure public good, when we think about, domestic financial regulation, as Andrew was talking about. And that is, just as we think individual banks will not internalize the cost their activities impose on a system, the failure of other banks, so the contagion that's been talked about in this class, one may argue that a single national regulator will not internalize the cost of national bank failures on a global system. And this is sort of not, his example is not having high enough capital requirements for their banks so they can compete with, more effectively in these international markets, and then their banks fail and it spills into the global system. Now, let me try to relate this to Basel. The short-term funding markets is where the panic began. And the point that I want to make is if we were to look at financial sectors across the industry and their portfolios that they held, we would see that banks' portfolios on average were more concentrated in the assets that blew up, where they were the epicenter of the financial crisis, securitized mortgages, or in particular subprime securitized mortgages, compared to non-Basel regulated financial institutions, such as hedge funds, pension funds, insurance companies, on average. Obviously, there are individual examples within all of these sectors that did better or worse. But if we looked at sort of them as an industry sector, the banks held more of them. They were less diversified, and that's the sector that blew up. Of course, that's the sector we're most important about, given their important role in the payment system and credit and the like. And the point here is that there are regulatory-induced incentives for institutions operating under Basel to hold these assets. The Basel risk rates preference residential mortgage-backed securities. And let me just sort of give an example of that. Under Basel I, banks had to hold capital based on risk rates. And mortgages were favored over corporations, loans to corporations, because for a corporate loan, you had to hold 100%. Right? When we're looking at mortgages, they only had to hold $4 in capital against every, you have an 8% requirement, so they only had to hold half compared to if this was $100 of a corporate loan, they'd be holding $8. For a residential mortgage, they only had to hold $4 in capital. But if you securitize that mortgage, they only had to hold $1.60. Right? So they could invest, if you sort of thought of this is in this is Gina Coppola, joined Gina Coppola's point about leverage, right? They could use $4 if they're holding one mortgage for $100. They could sort of magnify what they could buy with that if they securitized that, and it was $250 worth of that. Basel II reduced but didn't eliminate this discrepancy. And what Basel II brought in was credit ratings also were preferenced. Since subprime securitizations, as has already been mentioned, had AAA credit ratings, they were treated the same for capital purposes as a prime. So your incentive here is sort of, this is what when Andrew was saying the Basel I was crude, right? Within a given risk class that you have to hold a certain amount of capital, right? There's going to be gradations, right? So nothing was granular that you had individualized capital for every single asset. So you have some incentive to hold the one that's riskier because you're going to get a higher return, but you have to hold the same amount of capital for it. So there's some preferencing here. This is sort of regulatory arbitrage within the system, not across systems. Right, and so my argument then is that there was a preference for those under the Basel system, and so banks, it's not surprising that banks that were subject to those regulations, sort of the phrase is called, reaching for yield, held more of those assets. Another thing we should think about is value at risk. So when Andrew mentioned that they had internal models for market risk, Basel II actually extended that for not just market risk, but for credit risk and the like. Well, so all the banks were told to use the same model. So it wasn't even like every bank could have their own model. They took, I think it was JP Morgan was the one that invented VAR, and that was what they had to use in Basel. So let's think about that. So all the banks are using a certain system that says for a particular asset, we have to consider a certain loss. Right, then that asset, if it goes down in value, right, then value at risk tells you you have to hold more capital. They're all holding the same thing, they have the same models. So when these assets start going down in value, all of their models are showing that they have more risk, they got to get rid of those, and so you have this fire sale of everyone selling the assets. So these are some examples where harmonization, right, can contribute or exacerbate systemic risk. So my argument here is that It's possible, not necessarily true, but if banks worldwide were not incentivized by this international harmonization to follow the same strategies, maybe the crisis would have been more contained, right, in the U.S. and not as global in scope. Now, of course, it's not necessarily true, as already been mentioned, right, I guess in your lecture last time, you know, Ireland and Iceland, they were countries that had similar kinds of housing bubbles and didn't have subprime securitizations, right, and had similar problems of capital accounts and the like. So, you know, there are some issues, but if we think about transmission, so there is the question of what transmitted this contagion. Was it links across institutions, or it was just fundamental shock, right, which, you know, there's some, you know, data supporting both of these things. But the issue of here is, all I'm trying to suggest is that banks could follow the same strategies independent of there being regulation, right? So, you know, sort of people think about mutual fund managers, and there's this literature, Judy Chevalier on the faculty here has written on this, that they heard there's safety in numbers. If you all do the same thing, right, then they can't really have much performance, relative performance valuation of you, because then if one person fails, you're all failing and you're all holding the same assets. And so people argue, well, that could be true also with banks. I mean, the NYU, Vera Acharya and others have a model that says, well, you know, if one bank fails, they may not bail you out, but if you all fail, they're going to have to bail you all out, so let's all herd, and we're going to hold the same assets and follow the same strategies. But the point here is that this could be facilitated if you have regulations suggesting a strategy, then we can all herd on that strategy, right, that's facilitated by these global standards. So let me give sort of the first argument for regulatory diversity, which is related to what I just talked about, is reducing regulatory error. So the peril of harmonization is that it can increase systemic risk. So if the regulator makes a mistake, the point of regulation is to incentivize firms so that they do what you want them to do with the regulation, so firms that follow a flawed, broadly similar strategy will fail, and it's not going to be restricted to one bank, but it's going to be all banks, and it's not going to be restricted to one nation's banks, but it's going to be global. Right, when we have this. And so just to repeat ad nauseum here, banks levered up on Basel preferred securities whose opacity set off a panic in the shadow banking sector, triggering a global financial crisis. Right? With regulatory diversity, there is a chance that not all regulators will make the same regulatory error, so not all banks will be following the same strategy, and financial distress could be more likely to be localized. So the second argument is generating information. So regulatory diversity provides information about what works best by enabling us to be able to compare the performance of banking systems or banks operating under different regimes. There's considerable uncertainty, right, in financial markets. They're very dynamic. We have product innovation over time, right? But there's a lot of uncertainty about what's going on. How do we measure risk? So economists have been putting forth various types of measures, stock correlations and the like, but we don't have a good handle on that. More importantly, we have don't have a good idea of how do we identify future sources of systemic risk. Of course, as products are not even yet, you know, thought of, and as we invent new products, they create new risks. So the optimal kind of regulation, or in particular optimal capital requirements, is hard to know. Also, the state of art on the knowledge quickly obsolesces, and regulations that are appropriate when they're enacted may become inapposite as business, legal, and technological conditions rapidly change. Let's take the example of mortgages. So when Basel I, back in the 80s, late 80s, when they adopt the regime that says we're going to have a favorable risk weights for mortgages, okay, there's a political explanation. Nations like Germany and the U.S. wanted to foster home ownership, and they said, well, if we don't have a discount on holding mortgages, then banks might not hold as many mortgages. They won't make as many residential mortgages as we'd like them to do, because then they'll just lend to something else. So we want to favor it, but they also thought at the time, well, you know, mortgages seem to be safer than corporate loans. People put 20% down, they're prime borrowers, you know, people don't like to give up their house. So it might make sense to have them be half the risk rate of a corporate loan. Of course, when we come into 2006, right? We don't just have people putting 20% down. This is sort of Gina Coppola's big point. They're putting down 3%. They're putting down 0%. And they're subprime. They're people who are high credit risk. Now, those were structured as adjustable. So if Gary Gordon was talking about this, he would say, and I guess you talked about this too, they'd be structured in a way that the bank is trying to not take on massive risk and to, you know, make these affordable. But the nature of those then securities changed. But the Basel rules were unchanged, right? So they didn't adapt, right, to this thing. So they might have made sense. So in the benign view, they made sense, you know, back in 88. But by the time we got to 2006, 2007, it didn't make sense to have that anymore. Right? And so this is an issue, right? When we have this harmonized system and everyone's doing the same thing, you don't get information as quickly, right, up to the regulators of what's right. The last thing I would say about these markets is I would use a term that, you know, people use in this terrorism literature, and that is that dynamic uncertainty is involved with financial market risk. So we're thinking about things that have a very remote possibility of occurring but could have catastrophic consequences. When we're thinking about terrorists and we start, like, you know, looking in your bag in the airport for liquids, well, do we think the terrorists are going to now continue the same thing they did the last time? No, we think they're going to adjust. But the problem is we don't know how they're going to adjust. They don't necessarily adjust in a linear way or in a rational way that a regulator can figure that out. And so this is also true when we're thinking about banks. We know if we set capital requirement A, the bank is going to do the best it can to minimize that capital has to hold, so it's going to respond, but it's difficult to predict how they're going to respond or where the new risk is going to lie. So it would be useful then to have regulatory diversity, right, so that could improve the quality of decision-making of regulators, and our system then would evolve through informed experimentation. Last one is also a conventional kind of argument, is customization to context. If we think about Basel, though, only, you know, the G20 are members of the committee and have to comply, but basically all nations comply. The IMF and the World Bank encouraged emerging markets. In fact, they wouldn't fund them. They wanted them to comply. And so we find that they do. But greater regulatory variation may be desirable, particularly for emerging nations who have different levels of commercial and financial infrastructure development compared to more developed Basel committee members. Right? And so this is another reason for wanting diversity. In sum, I think the prevailing view on the appropriateness of global financial regulatory harmonization should be reconsidered. And the key that's been overlooked is that when regulation is harmonized, flawed policies can magnify systemic risk. I think Basel has repeatedly failed to meet its objective of reducing systemic risk, but to think that in changing circumstances, we've got many unknowns and unknowables, and we've got knowledge that obsolesces quickly because we're operating in uncertain and dynamic environments. So it's hard to think that we've got it right, that we want to sort of have something on a global scale rather than sort of inform ourselves through the experimentation that would come from a regulatory diversity, which, as I said, could be met by a peer review process that permits departures subject to ongoing monitoring.